Hello everyone. In this problem, we're going to discuss a spherical tank work problem. A water tower is spherical in shape with radius 50 feet extending from 200 feet to 300 feet above ground. Compute the work done in filling the tank from the ground. Okay. So, first we're going to draw a picture to better understand what the situation looks like. So we're going to draw the spherical tank on the left side. Gonna draw it pretty big because we okay, and then we have to draw a line segment which should be equal to 200 feet. Okay, something let me do a better one like this. Okay, so let's understand this from the very beginning, that this line segment this line segment should be equal to 200 feet. Okay? Because it says extending, this tank extends from 200 feet to 300 feet above ground, right? So now you can find out its diameter of the spherical tank in two ways. First, by looking at the radius, which is 50 feet, so you know that the diameter is 100 feet. Or from this second piece of information where it says extends from 200 feet to 300 feet above ground, right? So it's obvious that the diameter must be equal to, I'm just going to write it here, 100 feet. Okay, so notice that we're going to be pumping water into the tank, right? From the ground level. Okay, from the ground level. So I'm just going to say this is the ground. And since we're going to be pumping in, notice that there will be a force involved, okay, because the force of gravity will make sure that the water will not go up. So we have to counter that force of gravity in order to move water, right? Move it from the ground level to the top. Now notice that we cannot use force, work is equal to force times distance directly. One of the obvious reasons is because if we take, notice that the water pumped at the top of the tank will travel at a greater distance from the ground than the water being pumped in the, at the beginning of the tank. Okay? Because it's obvious, right? Because the distance from the ground will be 200 plus whatever the slice of water that you're going to be pumping in. Okay, so for this reason, we're going to talk about the slicing. Okay, so let's see how this works. Notice that you can think of a slice of water being pumped in. Okay, and we're going to draw this slice like that. Okay, so this is a slice of water, okay, which is approximately cylindrical in shape, okay, because this is a sphere, this is a spherical tank, and this is a slice. So if we have many of them, and many, what do I mean by many? We can take from the bottom to the top of the tank, there will be n slices, and n can be sufficiently large, and if we divide these slices, if we divide 100 the diameter, 100 by this n, then each slice will have a height 100 divided by n. Okay, so we can indicate the delta y as 100 divided by n, and we're going to say n slices of water. Each slice cylindrical. Okay? So, and why am I thinking of delta y and not delta x? Because we're talking about the vertical axis, right? We're talking about going from the ground to the top, right? So I'm not using the x in order not to confuse you, so I'm just going to use the y's. As we talk about the height and as we talk about the thickness, the height of this cylindrical slide. Now notice that the delta y is going to be also the height of each cylindrical slice. Okay? So we're going to say delta y height of each cylindrical slice. Okay, I cannot directly indicate this to you that there is a height because it's so small here. I mean, it's so thin that you can't see it. But if you would use a microscope, obviously you would have been able to see it. But in any case, each slice, and we drew this slice here, is going to be cylindrical in shape. Okay, because the more you have them, the more you will approach a cylinder with each slice. Okay, so n must be sufficiently large. Okay, so now we can use each slice, because this is only one slice that I've shown you, but there are infinitely many slices possible, right? So we can use each slice and think of the force required to pump to move this slice of water from the ground level to where it is. Okay, so let's indicate this distance from the bottom of the tank to this slice as ci. Okay, and this is a vertical distance, okay? So you will be pumping in this slice from the ground level to the slice level, okay? So it's going to be 200 plus ci, the distance that you will be pumping this slice into the tank, okay? So now why am I using the I? Because the I can be any number. We're using a subscript of I because ci can be this slice on top, it could be higher than that. There are infinitely many slices, right? So we have to have some kind of letter. I must be less than or equal to n, obviously, right? Because there will be n slices in total. And I is going to be equal to 1, okay? As the smallest value for the I, okay? Because C1 would mean the first slice that will be at the very bottom of the tank, right? The smallest slice. Okay, so now let's figure out the radius of this slice because it's cylindrical, right? So we're gonna divide this like that here to make sure that we understand that we're gonna be talking about the radius of this ith slice. Okay, so we're gonna indicate it as r subscript I. And now how are we gonna write this rth slice in terms of the ci, okay? And ci, remember, are the vertical values, right? The vertical distance, the ci. So let's use the radius provided, which is 50 feet. And we know that the radius extends from the middle, right, to the boundary, okay? And also we know that we can create a right triangle by simply completing it, including the height, okay? So the radius in this case of this ith slice will be the base of this triangle, okay? The hypotenuse will be the radius of the spherical tank, which is going to be 50 feet, okay? So we're going to write 50 feet. And notice that the height can be expressed as 50 minus ci, right? Because you can extend a similar radius all the way to the bottom of the tank, okay? It will be 50. But since there's already a ci here, ci distance from the bottom to this ith slice, then the remaining distance of the radius will be 50 minus ci. Right, and we're going to take the absolute value just in case so that we're not dealing with any negative numbers. Okay, so now we can actually express the radius of this ith slice by using the Pythagorean theorem. Okay, so let's see. So it's going to be the radius of the ith slice squared plus 50 minus ci squared is equal to 50 squared, right? And notice that we can solve for the ith radius, of the ith slice, right? So we're gonna keep it as radius squared I is equal to 50 squared minus 50 minus ci squared, and that's gonna give us. I'm not gonna do too much work, but I'm just gonna give you the answer. You will need to work out the algebra, but it's gonna give you 100 ci. Minus ci squared. Okay, minus ci squared. So that's going to be your final result for the radius. Now you might ask me, why are we needing the radius? Well, we will need the radius of this ith slice to find its volume. Okay, and we find its volume, and then we use that volume, and we're going to multiply that volume with the weight density of water. Okay. And then that way we will find the force required to move this ith slice. And notice that then we will be using the summation, and we're going to include all the slices together in the summation to find the total force required to move all these slices. Okay? But first let's worry about the ith slice. Okay? So this is the radius, and the force required, I'm going to indicate it as force required to move the ith slice with the subscript I, will be the volume of this slice, volume of cylindrical slice, multiplied by the weight density, right? The weight of water per unit volume. Weight of water per unit volume. And notice that the weight density, which is the weight of water per unit volume, takes care of the fact that the force is equal to mass times acceleration, right? Because remember, you learned that mg is the formula, right? And that's basically the weight, okay? And that makes sense, because you need to remain with mg, okay? So in other words, the volume will be canceled out, because it says the volume of cylindrical slice times the weight of water per unit volume. So obviously the units of volume will be canceled out, and what will remain is the weight of water. Okay, and that's exactly what you should need, right? Because you need to find the force required to move the weight, to move the ith slice of water. Okay. So now let's substitute in the variables that we know. So it's going to be, what's the volume of cylindrical slice? We already found the radius. So it's going to be pi r I squared h, okay, times, and the weight of water per unit volume is 62.4 pounds per cubic feet, per cubic foot. Okay, and this is going to be cubic feet, obviously, right? Because this is volume. Okay, so now we're going to substitute in the radius that we found, which was 100 ci minus ci squared, right? So it's going to be 100 ci minus ci squared, right? And we're going to include the pi before it. Okay. And then you might ask me, what is the height? Well, the height, as we discussed earlier, was delta y, right? The height of each cylindrical slice, right? So it's going to be delta y. Okay. It's going to be the same height for all of them, right? Because we're dividing. We found the delta y by dividing 100 by n, with n being sufficiently large, right? So it divides it into equal heights. Okay, the radiuses will be different, obviously, for each slice, because the sphere changes, right? The radiuses are different, but the thickness, or the height in this case, of the cylindrical, of each cylindrical slice will be the same. Okay, that's why delta y applies to all slices. So now, what are we going to do next? Well, we're going to try to simplify. Well, also we're missing 62.4. So we're going to have 62.4 multiplied to that, and that's going to be in pounds, right? And that makes it true because force is expressed in pounds. Okay. So now that's the force required to move the ith slice. Now we're ready to actually calculate the work required to pump this ith slice from the ground level to the level in which the slice is located. Okay, and notice that the distance, in this case you will apply this formula, and I'm going to write it here. Force is equal to, work, not force, we already did the force. So work is equal to F times D. Okay, so now we found the force and the distance. So we're going to say distance pumped is going to be 200 plus CI. And that should make sense because we're pumping from the ground level, right? We're moving the slice from the ground level 200 feet up plus the CI in order to get to that slice, wherever that's going to be. Okay, so 200 plus CI is the pumping distance for each slice. So now we're ready to substitute in the numbers. So the work required to pump this ith slice from the ground level to where it is, it's going to be, let's see, so we have 62.4 pi, and let's take the CI outside, okay, and we can have 100 minus CI. And then what else are we missing? 662.4 pi CI, 100 minus CI, delta Y. I think that's the only thing that we're missing. What else is there? I think that's it. Okay, so that's the work required. Now, we know that we need to also use the distance. Sorry about that. So it's going to be 200 plus CI, right? Because the work is now using the including the distance multiplied to the force, right? So 200 plus CI. So now this looks long, right? But it's correct so far. So now let's actually find out the work required to pump all n slices, okay? And notice that we cannot say that it's going to be exact work, so we're going to say approximately, because we don't know what n is, okay? We say it's sufficiently large, okay? There are n slices, but we don't know how large should we get. Should we go to infinity? But if we're not going to infinity, we're going to approximate it first, right? So we're going to use the summation rule from I is equal to 1 to n for each slice, and we're going to include this information, 64 pi CI, 100 minus CI, and let's keep that 200 plus CI right after it to make it easier, and then multiplying it by delta Y. Now, like I said, if you want to make it exact work, then you will need to take the limit from n. So as n approaches infinity, you will take the limit of the summation from I is equal to 1 to n. This will give you exact work, right? Because you're never stopping. You're never stopping to count how many slices that you're going to divide the diameter to, right? So n is going to be the infinite number of slices. So if you go infinitely, obviously you're going to approach exact work. Okay? So now it's going to be, we're going to copy down the same thing, 62.4 pi CI, 100 minus CI times 200 plus CI delta Y, and that's going to give you now, since this is going to be exact work, we know that if we take n to infinity, this should be familiar to you, that we're actually approaching a definite integral. Okay, so your CIs will approach Y values, right? So you're going to substitute in Y for the CI here. If you take the definite integral, so it's going to be 62.4 pi. That's constant, so we take it outside of the integral. The integral would be from 0 to 100, right? Because we're integrating over the diameter of the spherical tank. Okay, and we know the diameter is 100, so the integral must be from 0 to 100, obviously. So we took the 62.4 pi out, so CI is turning to Y. And then we have 100 minus Y. Okay, let me write it a little better. And then we have 200 plus Y. And then, as you should know, the delta y is the thickness, right? And the thickness turns to simply dy in the integral. Okay, that should be clear. And then what happens after that? Well, after that, we're just going to simplify it. I'm not going to show you algebraic work, how I did it. But I'm just going to write it on the left side. So we're going to simplify this integrand, and we're going to have 62.4 pi from 0 to 100. And we're going to have 20,000 y minus 100 y squared minus y to the third dy. Okay? And that, and I'm just going to take the definite integral. And again, I'm not going to do complete work, but I will try to explain how I did it. Okay, so 62.4 pi, it's constant, so that remains. And then we're going to bracket. And as we take the definite integral, remember that the power of the y will increase by 1, and then you will have to divide by that power. So dividing 20,000 by 2 will give us 10,000 y. Oh, sorry. That will be y squared. So I'm just going to take the upper limit, the 100, and I'm going to square that. So I'm going to have 100 squared. And remember, I'm not going to subtract 0 because 0 squared is just 0, right? So it makes it easy, actually. So we just have to worry about the 100 when we evaluate the definite integral, okay? And then the second term, the one that says minus 100 y squared, will turn into minus 100 over 3 y to the third, okay? So that means we will have 100 over 3. And then we're going to cube the 100, right? Because y is to the third now, so we're going to cube the 100. And then finally, the last term turns into minus 1 over 4, right? Because the power of the y increases by 1, and we have to divide by that as well, so it's minus 1 over 4. Y to the fourth, right? So 100 must be quadrupled. So it's going to be quadrupled. Oops. Okay, now we can close the bracket. And what this should give you, let me quickly use my calculator to make sure it will give you the correct answer. Let me see, so 10,000 times 100 squared minus 100 quadrupled divided by 3 minus 100 quadrupled divided by 4. Okay, so that gives me, 41,666,666, and we have to multiply that by 62.4 pi, so times 62.4 times pi. Okay, so that's correct. It should give you the answer, the final answer should give you 8,168,140,000. I really hate my handwriting, sorry about that. Why am I writing? So, okay, so 140,899 foot pounds. Okay, foot pounds. And why is it foot pounds? Because work was in the formula, force times the distance, right? And force was measured in pounds, and distance was measured in feet, So it makes sense that we have foot-pounds as the units for the work done. Okay, so now you successfully solved this problem. It's a very long problem, but as you can see, it's such a fun problem to be able to understand and solve it. Hope it was helpful. Please subscribe, and I'll see you in my next video.